Welcome back, aliens. My name is Davin Reddy, and let's continue with this series on JavaScript. Now, this video is important, but not just that, it's also interesting. And the topic is the history of JavaScript. See, every language, doesn't matter if it's C, C++, Java, PHP, Ruby, every language has a history. Some histories are interesting, some are not, but JavaScript has a very interesting history. And the history is important because whatever you do, whenever you work on a new feature, you should know in which version it came and will it work on the browser which you are working with. That's very important, right? So let's talk about the history. Now, to understand that, let's go back to 1990. Of course, that's way back, right? That's even before JavaScript was launched. Now, in 1990, one thing got famous, which is the internet. Of course, no one was knowing about it. Everyone just heard about the concept like internet, the way you know about blockchain now. You just know the word, right? You don't know the technology. In the same way, internet was new. Not everyone knew about it. And even if you ask someone, what is internet? They will be saying, hey, somewhere you are connecting multiple machines or you're sharing information. And that's the idea, right? Internet was all about sharing information. But who will use it? And that's where we thought, hey, you know, we have a lot of companies and they want to share their information. Instead of using templates, the way you use those yellow papers on the public places, you know, you distribute the templates. In the same way, you can share your company information online. And anyone can see it. So if you have a computer, just go to that website and you can see the information. And that's why everyone wanted to have their own website, provided they have enough money, right? So let's say if I'm the company, I want to have my own website, I will ask someone to make a website for me. And that someone will be called as a HTML author. I know that sounds weird, but that's what they used to call them, the HTML authors, because they used to create web pages. They used to design pages with the help of content. And to do that, we just need two things, HTML, CSS, design a page, you're done. And those pages were static pages. Every time someone goes there, they can see a simple page. Yes, there were hyperlinks. You can jump to one page and from the other page. But then it was not interactive. And so in 1993, when they wanted to have a good browser, of course, right, to view a web page, you need a good browser. So we got Mocha. So Mocha was one of the best browsers available at that time. So it got famous, right? And everyone wanted to have their own browsers now. So most of the tech companies, they thought, hey, that's a good business. Let's have our own browser. And that's where the founders or the developers of Mocha thought, hey, why don't we create a company and we'll commercialize this. And then they founded a company called as Netscape. Now Netscape created their own browser called Netscape Navigator. Now it was awesome, right? But since we got Netscape Navigator, there are other companies as well who thought, hey, you know, we got a new company who are able to create their own browser. We are tech giants. Can we have our own browser? I'm talking about Microsoft. So Microsoft thought, hey, we have a lot of money. We have a lot of developers. They can build a browser for us. And that is Internet Explorer. But the problem was in the case of Netscape, you have to buy Netscape Navigator. There was a time where people used to buy browsers, right? But it was worth, right? When you are able to access the internet, that means you are rich. That means you have money at that time, right? So people were buying Netscape Navigator. The entire business model of Netscape was based on the browser. They were making money because of Netscape Navigator. But Microsoft came into picture and say, hey, you don't have to pay for Internet Explorer. In the Windows OS, they added a component and then you got a free browser, right? And Netscape here thought, hey, we need to do something. We need to do something so that for two reasons. One, they want to stay in the market. And second, they want to give awesome experience to the users. No one wants to see a blank page or a page with just content, no interactivity. And that's where they thought, can we create some components which will be displayed on the page? So they wanted to have that and they approached Sun Microsystems. Now at that time in 1993 or 4, Java was getting very famous. It was not publicly launched, but then it was getting used in the enterprise and they thought, can we use this language on the browser? Maybe for the interactivity, let's say someone wants to give some information, if they want to see some animations on the web page, can we do that? Because Java was having applets, can we use applets on the screen? That was the idea. But then it didn't work that way. They wanted to go for Sun Microsystems Java, but they thought, can we create a new language? And that's where they hired Brendan Eich. Brendan Eich was a developer who was working on Scheme language. So he knew Scheme. So he thought, can we just build a new language? So Netscape said, hey, Brendan, you have to make a new language using which user will be able to interact with the website. Just make a language which using which you can make beautiful pages, not just the way they look, but the way they interact. And the deadline given as soon as possible. Maybe if they might have said today itself they want a new language. But Brendan took 10 days to make a language. Maybe this is the first language which was developed in 10 days, right? So we got a new language in 10 days. And of course, right, whenever you have something that quick, imagine you're building a language, a programming language in 10 days. It will have some bugs. It will have some issues. It will have some awesome features. Although the only caveat is the language which was developed then is way different from what you're using now. It was a small language with less features. Now you have so many features available, right? But still it has bugs, and the same bugs are still there in the language because the language is backward compatible. So enough about the issues. Let's talk about the language. And the name of the language was Mocha. Awesome name, right? So initially they went with Mocha name, but while launching, they changed the name to LiveScript. So that was a good name. But the only problem is in the internet market, it was new. Not everyone wanted to have their own website. So can we just market this language as an awesome language? And of course, Netscape wanted to market it in such a way that this language will be used only in the Netscape Navigator. And if you want to access the pages, you have to buy Netscape Navigator. That was a strategy. They renamed the language from LiveScript to JavaScript because Java was famous, right? And then can we use the same name? So maybe they wanted to show it's a cousin of Java. Technically, they have some similarities because Netscape approached Sun for the language. They copied some of the concepts from the C family, right? C, C++, Java. So it has curly brackets. So they thought, hey, that makes sense, right? Let's have a name as JavaScript. So somewhere in 1995, they released their own language called JavaScript in the new browser called Netscape Navigator 2, and everything was good, right? So somewhere Netscape was actually winning the competition, right? Because all the other companies don't have a language. Now in this case, Microsoft says, okay, you got your language. So now that's 1-0, you are winning, but don't worry. What Microsoft did is, in fact, they have a lot of resources, they have people, they have money. So they reverse engineered JavaScript and they created their own language. Okay, now this is a tricky part. First of all, they reverse engineered the language JavaScript. So of course the new language will be similar to JavaScript. Now the second question was, what should be the name of a new language? They did some research, they worked very hard. They thought about this for 2 minutes and they thought, hey, let's go with a new language called Jscript. Okay, so that's how we got a new language called Jscript. So now we have two languages, JavaScript and Jscript. The thing is, JavaScript only works on Netscape Navigator. Jscript only works on IE. Now as a developer, when you are making a website, or as a designer, when you are making a website, which one you will choose? So if you are making a website only using JavaScript, it will only work on Netscape Navigator. If you are making a website using Jscript, it will only work on IE. And that's why, in fact, that was a big diversion. And that's why most of the websites, they were mentioning at the bottom, best viewed in IE or best viewed in Netscape Navigator. So that was a big issue, right? So first of all, they copied the language, they copied the name, plus they made Internet Explorer free. Now, when you get the same feature of a browser, so let's say if I give you two applications, one you have to buy it, one is free, both are same. Of course, you will go for the free version, right? And everyone went for IE for two reasons. It was free and everyone was using Windows. That was the only major OS available, right? So Windows was having the maximum market share. IE was getting a lot of market share. And at this point, Netscape thought, okay, now that's tricky. IE is again winning the competition. Microsoft is winning the competition now. So that's 1-1. Or that's actually 2-1 because Microsoft has market share. It has a free IE. Now in this case, Netscape went to ECMA. Basically, it's a ECMA International, which stands for European Computer Manufacturers Association. So they are responsible to create standards. So basically, we have two languages doing the same thing, and they don't have anything in common. So can we create a standard so that JavaScript will become a standard language which will be used by everyone? And that's what happened. So ECMA used JavaScript. They created a new standard called ECMAScript. Now ECMAScript is a standard with definitions and the protocols. So whenever you have a new language, it should follow that ECMAScript. The advantage would be In future, if you are using a language, irrespective of JavaScript or some other language, but if that is following ECMAScript, that means you have something in common. You don't have to write best viewed in IE anymore. So that was the idea. The amazing part is ECMA is not just giving standards to JavaScript. They have multiple technology to give standards to, like C# and C++, CLI, JSON. So the first part of ECMAScript, which is ECMAScript One, was launched in 1997. So somewhere, everyone thought, now JavaScript is a main language, right? It's a primary language. So people were moving towards JavaScript. Everything was going good. But then in 3 years, of course, in three years, we got three ECMAScript, and somewhere Microsoft thought, that's the future, right? We have to follow ECMAScript. But then they had two mindsets here. First, they don't actually want to go for ECMAScript because it's a representation of JavaScript. But then they were not having any choice, right? So there was a confusion here. But in 1999, something happened. In fact, in 2000, something happened. The dot-com bubble burst. Because at that point, as I mentioned before, everyone wanted to have their own website, right? So, and then if you have your own website, you need someone to build it. So as a company, if you are responsible to build websites, you will be getting good amount of investors, and the value of your company was high, very high. It was a bubble, actually, the way the things are going for Dogecoin, right? So it was a bubble, and which got burst in year 2000. The entire tech market was going down. Not all companies, some companies survived, and they are the leaders now, the company who survived the dot-com bubble. The moment you have a dot-com bubble, everyone lost hope from the tech world, at least from the internet world. They thought it's not going anywhere, but internet is still there. Websites are still there, but it took some time to, you know, to come into that picture again. Until that point, in fact, in 1999, Netscape was so much in loss. So Netscape got sold, and the company who bought Netscape was AOL. So that was the end of Netscape. But before selling the company, what they did, they took the source code of Netscape Navigator and they made it open source. Any guess? The reincarnation of Netscape Navigator? Firefox. So the Firefox browser which you use now is actually the reincarnation of Netscape Navigator. Now coming back to ECMAScript. What happened after 1999? Because we got ECMAScript 3. What about the next version? So we got three versions in 3 years. The next version was on waiting. Because the next version was ECMAScript 4. The problem is, they in that 2 years or 3 years gap, they thought we can include a lot of new features. Looking at other languages, we have so many features, right? We don't have them in JavaScript. Can we just use those features? This is good, this is good, this is good. And they have their own ideas. But the problem is, whenever you have this bunch of concepts coming together, it's difficult to implement those things in one language in the next version. And plus, they were not having enough motivation to do that. So it was getting delayed and delayed and delayed because no one was able to implement the concept properly, and then and it was not able to release. So they had those concepts and they kept it aside. And then they launched ECMAScript 3.1, which was having some minor updates, but not anything major. What happened to ECMAScript 4? It was not implemented in JavaScript, but then there was a company called Macromedia. Now Macromedia said, okay, this is our awesome specification. Let's have our own scripting language, which is ActionScript. So Macromedia went with ActionScript, right? Which is ECMAScript 4. So things were not going anywhere for JavaScript. It was still called as a client-side language, and it was there, but nothing major was happening. Something happened in 2005. In 2005, we got Ajax. So someone wrote a paper by saying, hey, now we can actually change the data in the page itself. So example, in those days, if you want to change the data of a page, you have to go to the next page. So even if you want to do a small change in a page, you have to call the next page. But nowadays we have a concept of single page application, and that is possible with the help of Ajax. So it was very famous, right? So Ajax is something which has given the boost JavaScript needed. So again, in 2008, when we got some new features in JavaScript, it was getting used, Ajax was getting famous, jQuery was getting famous. Someone thought, hey, can we use these features? Because see, to run a JavaScript language, you need an engine. Because JavaScript being a interpreted language, that's right, it's an interpreted language. So what is interpreted language means? So whenever you have a source code, doesn't matter which language it is, if it is an interpreted language, the execution will be done line by line. So let's say we have 10 lines of code, it will execute line by line. The only problem is it is slow because at the time of execution, you are passing the lines. On the other hand, when you say compiled languages, the entire code gets compiled. right? You find errors, if there's any errors or not. If it is getting successfully compiled, that means there is no syntactical errors. You just have to create a file, and that file will be executed on the machine, which is a bit faster. And JavaScript was slow because it was interpreted. Something happened in 2008. Google came up with their own browser, and every browser had their own engine. Example, in IE, we had a different engine. For Mozilla Firefox, we had a different engine. Chrome says, hey, we will give you a different engine, a V8 engine. What's so amazing about it? The amazing thing is now your JavaScript files will be both compiled and interpreted. That's amazing, right? It introduced something called just-in-time compiler. And that was amazing. So now, since it is fast, can we use JavaScript on a machine? So now it's an easy language and it is fast. So they wanted to write JavaScript application which will run directly on the OS. And that's where we got a new environment called Node.js. So what's a Node.js? Node.js is an engine, or it's an environment which has a JavaScript engine. So basically, using Node.js, you can build application not just as a browser frontend, but the backend application, the desktop application, anything you wish, which you want. And that's where JavaScript got the boost, which you can see now. And in the same year, you got ECMAScript 5. So in 2009, we got ECMAScript 5. Can you see that? The gap of 10 years. In 1999, we got ECMAScript 3. 4 was crap. So we got 5 in 2009. That's amazing. And you can imagine how many features we got. And someone called it as a modern JavaScript because it has so many features, amazing features. And then it was getting famous. You can write applications on the desktop. You can write applications for the websites, for the backend servers, everything with the help of Node.js. And then they thought, okay, now we got some new features. In 2015, we got ECMAScript 6. Now that's a new benchmark. So every time you have amazing features, you say that's a new benchmark, right? ECMAScript 5 was a benchmark. ECMAScript 6 was our next benchmark. Now, after that, in 2015 as well, we got so many new ECMAScript versions, but still we talk about ECMAScript 6 because it introduced new concepts which is getting used by everyone. Now, the current version of ECMAScript is ECMAScript 12. Now, can you imagine that in 6 years, we got 6 new versions? It's because after ES7, they decided to go for yearly versions. So every year you will get new version. So we got ES7 in 2016, we got ES8 in 2017. Now instead of calling us ES7 or ES8, they changed their nomenclature. So they said, okay, let's enough of ES5, ES6, let's go for the year number now, because the updates will be coming every year. So officially we can call it as ES2015, ES2016, ES2017. So the current version is not ES12, we will not call that. We'll say it is 2021, right? So it is coming in June, I guess. So that's the latest version which you can use. Now the question arises, if you want to learn JavaScript, which version you will be using? You will be using 6 or 10 or 11 or 12. That depends upon the browser compatibility. The moment you use new features, it will not work on the old browser. So the language is backward compatible. That means you can still use old features, but it's not forward compatible. So you can't use new features in the old browsers. And that's where we need transcompiling, where you need a certain libraries which will help you to do that. Now, what happened to Jscript? What happened to ActionScript? Everything got scrapped. So no one using Jscript now, no one using ActionScript. The only language is JavaScript. So what happened to Macromedia? Adobe acquired Macromedia. What happened to Sun Microsystems? Oracle acquired Sun Microsystems. Who owns the trademark of JavaScript? It's Oracle. Why? It's because, remember, Sun was involved when they wanted to have a language, JavaScript. So the trademark was registered by Sun. Oracle bought Sun, so now trademark belongs to Oracle. You can still use it. They're not claiming any trademark there, but it's worth mentioning. So that's it from this video. I hope you enjoyed it. Let me know in the comment section and do subscribe for further videos. Bye.